We want to look this morning in the first 13 verses of Acts chapter 2. It's a very important passage in the whole of the Bible. It explains so many things to us. It's a real challenge to read it and to be aware of your inadequacy to actually explain it. But here we are. We want to look at the birth of the New Testament Church of Christ. The birth of the Church of Christ. Do you remember maths from school? Well, some of you are still active at school, so you're probably doing some form of maths with children. But for most of us, it's a long time ago. It was one of my favourite subjects when I was at school. But it became a favourite because very early on, somebody taught me 1 plus 1 equals 2, 2 plus 2 is 4, if you multiply them together. And we got all those very basic foundational details. So when we came to algebra, when we came to geometry, when we went on to study various physical laws for the courses we followed, it was all based on that very basic, simple building block. If we hadn't had the building block, geometry and algebra would mean nothing to us. In fact, you can still see folks panic, can't you, when you put algebra, x plus b equals c. What? Until you know how to work with it, you don't understand what it is. Now, I use that as an illustration because what you have here in the passage before us is the very most basic, fundamental explanation of who the church is. And it's only by understanding this that the rest of the book fits together. And so I fear that we need to look at this long and hard. I'm very conscious of my limitations as I come to it, but let me pass on to you what's been laid on my heart this week. That here we have the outpouring of the Spirit, and in the outpouring of the Spirit, the fundamental basic principle of the Church of God, where Christ now reigns and will one day cause this church to fill and to flood the whole earth. It's hard to even say it because in the days we live, it seems the very opposite. But you need to go back to Scripture and measure what's going on by the Bible, not by our experience or by our culture. I've only got two headings for you this morning. The New Testament Church of Christ is a Holy Spirit-filled church and thereby a Holy Spirit-enabled church. Filled and enabled. My first point then is that the Church of Jesus Christ is a Holy Spirit-filled church. There are many things going on in the chapter in front of us, and we'll tease out some of the details as God enables us, but what you have to capture here is, why is this here in the text? What was the purpose of putting it here in the Bible? Could the Bible have left this out altogether? No. Because even as Peter stood up to preach in response to what was happening, he made it very clear, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. This is what was anticipated, not only in Joel, we'll come to that in a couple of weeks' time, but this is what was promised all the way down through the Old Testament. Not only was Christ promised as the Savior of sinners, he promised that he would have a people whom he would be king over, and that that people would survive upon the earth, and God would dwell in their midst. That's the church. Of course, it's easy to see why people are so confused nowadays. We live in a world where people think a church is a building. We live in a world where we think that church is, well, what is it? Because it's different everywhere you go. You've got Methodists and Protestants and Baptists and Congregationalists and Evangelicals. So what is church? I really want us just to get back here and capture this little cameo of what church is, so that we will then be better equipped to understand why there is such diversity. The church was born at Pentecost. I've spoken all the way through chapter 1 about Jesus' work and Jesus' workers. Jesus' workers were in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. all gathered in one place, according to verse 1. And as they were gathered, they experienced and received the fulfillment not only of the promises of the Old Testament, but the promises of Jesus. Remember in chapter 1, wait at Jerusalem until you are baptized with the Holy Spirit. This is the realization of all the work that Jesus has accomplished. God is now coming to dwell with men and women and establish his kingdom upon the earth. Those who were united by the grace of God individually, born of his Spirit, brought into God's family as children of God, are now brought together as a community, as a body. In fact, the Lord uses that analogy, or Paul uses it of the Lord, doesn't he, in 1 Corinthians, that we are the Lord's body. Elsewhere, we are his temple, not only as an individual, but most especially as a group of people. We are what God had promised, a new covenant community, saved by the blood of Christ, loved from eternity by God, and placed on the earth to be his witness. And the great truth of the gospel is that we are not left here to do the work of God in our own strength or on our own power. The Saviour had spoken in three chapters in John's Gospel, 14, 15 and 16, about the advantage of his going away and the Holy Spirit coming. These words are from John 14, 16. I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. Underline that. He's not just for here for a visit. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him. And notice this, for he dwells with you. That indicates, you see, there's been a work of grace in their minds and hearts. They're God's people. But then the promise goes on, and will be with you. And then what I find to be one of the most profound verses in the Bible, John 14, 18. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. Here is a picture. The Holy Spirit comes, and in his coming, Christ is present in our life. And that gives us the hope of glory according to the scriptures. Christ in you, the hope of glory, because he died for us, because he made us his own. And the Holy Spirit's work then is to confirm us as the people of God, to bind us to God himself by his grace through the death of Christ, and then to bind us to one another in this world as a testimony to the reality of God's presence. Look at some of the details in the verse 2. And suddenly, it was there 1 minute, it wasn't there the moment before. Grasp the picture here. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. This great sound, this indescribable noise, made everybody sit up. They were not the only ones to hear it. Verse 6, and when this sound occurred, the multitude came together. It was an audible sound in the midst of the community that caught people's attention. It was God's announcement of the Holy Spirit coming into the presence of his people. And it came like the sound of a mighty rushing wind. If you've heard a great storm coming, Kath and I survived a cyclone in Airy Beach in Australia many years ago, 4 or 5 years ago now. And it was an awesome experience. The noise was phenomenal. I was asking Melinda about tornadoes in Kansas, and of course they've all got cellars that they go down into and avoid it. There were no cellars where we were. And I'm a sound sleeper anyway. But the noise, you can't miss the fact that it's happening. This is the meaning of the text here. Something happened which was phenomenal. It wasn't the wind. Remember, it says it was like a wind. It sounded like the wind. It was echoing like the wind. It was God announcing to the world that he was present and about to act. You get a similar picture in Acts 4:31. It says, and when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God with boldness. You see, God is shaking the world awake at this point, because it has to be clear that God himself has in fact come to fulfill the promises of his word. The use of the word wind in the text is significant, because in both Hebrew and Greek, the same word, sorry, let me get this right. In Hebrew and Greek, the word for spirit and wind are the same. In Hebrew it's ruach, in Greek it's pneuma. But the symbolism of it is what should strike us. For all through the Bible, God has used this kind of a symbol to illustrate the presence of his Holy Spirit. Ezekiel 37 is the account of the Valley of Dry Bones. And after looking at the bones, the prophet is told in Ezekiel 37:9, prophesy to the breath or to the wind. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain that they may live. And of course, I hope you know the account to refer to in your own mind, whereby the spirit came and the bones were joined together. We have a song, wasn't it? The knee bone was joined to the thigh bone. I'm not going to sing for you. Yeah, but you know what it's like. And all this came together, and God made again new and living people. In the same chapter, verse 14, I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live. And I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and performed it, says the Lord. This phenomenal appearance, no, this phenomenal sound of the wind, ties us right back in through the Old Testament to the promise of the power of God coming to be in and among his church. It then goes on to say, then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat on each of them. Notice again, it's as of. These are not actually physical tongues of fire. The word tongues of fire is the writer's best way of describing what he saw. It looked like it were little flames on each individual's heads, according to the next verse. But it takes us back again into the teaching of Jesus. It takes us back into the ministry of John the Baptist. Luke 3:16. John says, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. The sound displays the power and the majesty. The appearance of what looked like a flame takes us back again into the picture of God in the Bible. The book of Hebrews will tell us our God is a consuming fire. When Moses was on the backside of the mountain, what happened? There was a bush burning but not being consumed, and he was brought into the presence of a living God. You see, fire is a picture of God's holiness and righteousness. There's power, there's the presence of the Holy and Righteous One in their midst. And fire is also significant in the Old Testament for its use in the making of sacrifices and offerings. Fire is also present when covenants are established. You find it in Genesis 15:17. It came to pass when the sun went down and it was dark, but behold, there appeared a smoking oven and a burning torch that passed between those pieces. That's the first covenant with Abraham. The symbolism of fire is that God is present, the power is present, God is present. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat on each of them. This is a phenomenal moment in the history of the world. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues. Notice, as the Spirit gave them utterance. This is the real miracle. that God could take these ordinary people. You'll notice later on in the passage in verse 7 it says, look, are not all these who speak Galileans? Galileans in our language would be country bumpkins, who have an accent which is strong. They're fishermen, but they're not well educated. And so these people are scratching their heads. How is it possible that these very ordinary men and women, because both would be here, are now talking in languages they've never learned? It's the power of the Holy Spirit who has come upon them. It's the fulfillment of the promise of Christ. He had been baptized with the Spirit as he came up out of the water. You remember when John baptized them with water? Here we have the fulfillment of the promise that after not many days you will be baptized in the Spirit, which is in chapter 1. One writer puts it like this. Somebody's moved it. Since the wind of the Spirit filled the whole room where the disciples were sitting, that room became a kind of baptistry in which they were immersed in the Spirit. But just as the Spirit filled the room, the Spirit also filled them, just as the Spirit had filled Jesus upon his baptism in water. You see, they are now immersed in the Spirit. But it's not simply external, it's internal, so it's thereby described as a filling. And once a man or a woman is filled with the Spirit, they then become God's representative, his mouthpiece. I was thinking just this morning, we often get worried about how can I tell other people the gospel? And when you hear people saying to you, you're to be a witness, we tremble, don't we? Because we're very much aware that we're only human, we're timid, we don't have all the answers, and you might then want to run away and hide somewhere. But the wonder of the gospel is, you see, you're not supposed to do it in your own strength. You're not supposed to do it because you're clever, because you've got all the answers, because you've studied, because you can catch everybody at every turn. These are very ordinary people who have been born again by the Spirit of God and now brought together by the Spirit of the God of God to be the people of God. And as such, they're equipped to be bold and to speak freely and to pass on the word of God. This is, as I said to you earlier, a picture of the church. This event only ever took place once in history. And since that day, every true believer is indwelt by the Holy Spirit. Romans chapter 8 says that if you don't have the Spirit of God, you're not a Christian. We may not hear a great noise. We may not see something that looks like tongues of fire. But what will happen is our lives will, in fact, display the presence of the Holy Spirit, because he's a Holy Spirit. He changes us. He makes holiness our goal, our aim, and our purpose. He's a Spirit who is transforming us into the likeness of Jesus. So our lives talk. And then, as we are asked to give a reason for the hopes within us, our tongues are released. We know we've been bought by Jesus' blood. We know that, like Murray McShane, once we were indifferent to what sin is, but now we're aware and tremble at the thought of sin coming between us and God. Now we're aware that Christ paid the penalty for our sin, and through faith in him, we are made new creatures. We have a glorious hope. All of that is the work of the Holy Spirit. Theologically, it's called regeneration. Biblically, John chapter 16, he will convince the world of their sin. He will convince the world of righteousness, of a need for righteousness. He will convince the world that there's judgment coming. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit thereby is in everybody who knows that they believe in Christ, that they are Christ's. We've been filled, but I've said it so many times, you're probably tired of it. The lady in Kirby Moorside, whose name's escaping me after I preached on this once, she says, our trouble is we're leaky buckets. Somehow or another, what happens is, as the Bible says, is we quench the Spirit, we grieve the Spirit. And so the scriptures are very clear in the book of Ephesians that we are to keep on being filled. Chapter 3, I think, verse 21. It's important that in our English it says be filled, but if you look at the Greek, it's keep on being filled. It needs to be a day and daily experience where we go back to God, we confess our sin, we say, Lord, what I need today is you in my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Because otherwise I'm a liability. Otherwise I'm just going to go with the crowd. Otherwise I'll lose heaven itself. We need to be filled. I came across this illustration. How do I know the Holy Spirit is living in me? The writer went on to say, I know in the same way that I know there's music on a CD, even though I don't see the music on the CD. I can know that in either of two ways. I can believe the label that says there's music, or I can play the CD and hear it. We can know the Holy Spirit dwells in us by believing God who tells us in his word, or by seeing results in our life of when we obey him. The Holy Spirit has come, and the church now is the Spirit-filled body of Christ. Paul, writing to the Galatians, says, walk in the Spirit. It's important for us to grasp this, because we have an incredible tendency to gravitate back to religion. And that's been the killer of Christianity down through the centuries. God does a mighty work, we sometimes call it revival, and then within two generations it's just religion. People just going through the routine, doing what they think they should do. And if you ask them, they think that they're doing this so that God will love them. They lose sight of the wonder of the gospel of Christ. And therefore, as Christians, you and I are called to day and daily be renewing in our hearts and minds our vows and commitment to pursue and to flee after Christ, that we might have him in our life. Remember, the Holy Spirit doesn't talk about himself. You know he's present because he talks to you about Jesus. When the devil says you're no good, you agree with him and you say, Jesus is more than good. He's my Savior. I'm depending on him. Oh, dear friends, I think this needs to be at the heart of us as a church. When we see our smallness and we face the great uphill struggle to take the gospel to a world that's not interested, you and I need to be so aware of God in our life by his Spirit that we are thereby equipped to bear this message to a dying world. Another illustration I read was from D.L. Moody, who apparently one day held up a glass in the pulpit. And he asked the question, how can I get the air out of this glass? Well, one man gave the obvious answer. Suck it out with a pump, he said, to which Moody replied, that would create a vacuum and shatter the glass. So he waited for a while with some other answers, and then he took a jug of water and he poured the water into the glass. There, he said, all the air is now completely removed. And he then went on to explain that's how a Christian's life should be. We're not at peace with sin in our life, but how are we going to get sin out of our life? We're not at peace with our inability to talk, but how are we ever going to change that? If the preacher just tells you to try harder, be better, do more, then he's abusing you. The answer is get back to Calvary. Claim the power and the presence of the Spirit. And we need to claim that as a church. That's one of the reasons for our prayer meetings, is it not? Lord, this is your church. Come and fill us and equip us and use us. The Holy Spirit-filled body of Christ is his church. They are now holy people. We miss it, don't we, in our New Testament epistle. Paul writes to the saints. And we have this, can't get away from it, can we? We have this picture of somebody with a halo around their head standing like a statue. But of course the Bible word for saints, the word that's translated saint, is simply holy. To those who are the holy ones. Those who are the indwelt by the Spirit ones. Those who are the Spirit's blood-bought people, the church. And it's when he comes then that we are enabled to bear the gospel to the world. I'm still trying to come to terms with this great truth that Christ is building his church, and that rather than build it by himself, what he has planned and purpose is to build it through his people. Can you imagine that? You know what it's like? You ask the children to do something and it just never seems to get done, and then finally says, out of the way, I'll do it myself. And you can actually get into a habit where you don't even ask anymore, you just do it yourself. The Saviour never does that. The Saviour has ordained that the church will be built, and that it will be built through his Spirit-enabled people. And you get this little picture of it happening right here in verses 5 through to 13. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem devout men from every nation under heaven. The event takes place on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after Passover. In Jewish history, it was a feast which celebrated the gathering in of the harvest. You remember the Saviour told them to wait till the Spirit was poured out? Why were they waiting? Well, every Jewish male was obliged to be in Jerusalem for the Feast of Pentecost. Now obviously not everybody came, but great multitudes came from all over the world of their day, and that's what you have there in the list, don't you? My Bible's got a map. And it shows me that what this list tells me is that people came from all four corners of the Roman Empire back to Jerusalem. They were in the city, Parthians and Medes and Elamites, that's from the country of Iran. Judea, you know, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia. In ancient times, Asia was not the far, get my geography right, eastern continent we know. It was in fact Turkey and parts of what we now know as Greece. Parts of Libya joining Cyrene were in North Africa. And just almost as an aside, visitors from Rome. Cretans from the island of Crete, I don't know why they're highlighted, but they're there. And Arabs. The Arab Peninsula is below Israel. What we now know as Saudi Arabia, Yemen, Kuwait, and all those other countries. These people were obedient to the Jewish law. They were back in the city. Apparently some of them came at Passover and they had a 50-day holiday. They stayed there for the whole, that'd be 7 weeks. And here God is gathering them together so that he might, through his church, bring the gospel to their attention. And again, we need to back up. The church are individuals, it's not bricks and mortar. Through the church, who are testifying to the wonderful works of God. Did you notice that in the passage? It comes out, doesn't it, in verse 11. We hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. What are the wonderful works of God? Well, you could list creation and various other things. But at that time, what they're listing is Jesus' holy and righteous life. Jesus, in just wicked execution. He'll bring it up later on, won't he? Jesus, then, although there were guards on the tomb who came back from the dead. You see, by the power of the Spirit, these people, as the Spirit gave them utterance, as God equipped them to speak, would be speaking about these things in languages they had never learned, languages which matched the hearer, a miracle of God's grace, is symbolizing for us the fulfillment of a promise that when they went out into all the world, there would be people to believe, and there would be people to be baptized. When they went out into the world as witnesses, God would go with them. And here he's brought the world to them, but ultimately they'll go and meet the rest of the people. This astounding crowd should be a great encouragement to us. For as Christians, we need in our day to be praying for a new filling of the Holy Spirit. There's been a prayer meeting now for about 4 years, every 3 months on a Saturday morning. And it's a very simple thing, and I think as the time goes on, we're being tested as to whether we're serious. It's called a concert of prayer. It takes its name from what happened in North America and what was called New England back in the 18th century, the 1700s. A concert of prayer was given, and the people prayed for 7 years. We're not even at the halfway mark yet, are we? But what happens is it challenges us. Do I really see the need? Do I really want this to happen? Can I actually believe that God does these things? Read Christian history. McShane is a fabulous example. You see, his labours in Dundee were exemplary, but he saw little for it. But 2 years after his death, there was an incredible revival in Dundee. He had sowed, he had labour. Maybe that's our job. All these years here in Ryedale, sowing and labouring and passing on the gospel, bathing it in prayer, pleading with God to take it and use it, because that's how he works. We're not spectators. We're not waiting to see what God might do in spite of us. We're actually alive to do what God will do through us. There's an amazing symbolism here, you see, in gathering all these nations. Many of the commentators think what you have here is the curse of the Tower of Babel reversed. Remember, the nations were dispersed because they wanted to create their own God. They were all given different languages so they couldn't understand. Here the gospel becomes the universal language of all the world for all the nations. And God's people saw this and stepped up to the mark. I like how it says in verse 14, but Peter standing up, it was almost too much to listen to. That somebody might suggest, oh, they're just drunk. They're just babbling. Peter understands that he's been called to such a ministry. Christ has himself commissioned him to do it. Oh dear brothers and sisters, that we might catch afresh the wonder and the marvel of how God plans to work in his world, how God intends to bring the gospel. It will not be easy. You have to see here immediately there are two groups of people, verse 12 and verse 13. Some of folks were scratching their head and saying, what is this? They were interested. Remember when Paul's in Athens and preaches Acts 17? Some of the people says, we must hear this man again. Others, they scoffed and attacked. And that's exactly the pattern. It's not going to be a smooth road. We're not just going to stand up and talk and suddenly everybody's going to fall down before Jesus. This is going to be a lifetime's work. A work of faith, calling on us to be who God has called us to be, because God's Holy Spirit people are his only mouthpiece in the world. He works by his Spirit, he works by his word, but faith comes through hearing. And hearing by the word of God. You see, there's to be a discussion of this, there's to be a declaration of this, there's to be a publishing of this. And as we do so, then we are to expect great things to happen. We are living in a very tough day as far as established Christianity goes, but the world out there has never been more adrift. It's pursuing anything it can I came across this quote yesterday about from Madonna. I never thought I'd quote Madonna from the pulpit. But this is what she said. My drive in life is from this horrible fear of being mediocre. That's always been pushing me. Because even though I've become somebody, I still have to prove I'm somebody. My struggle has never ended and it probably never will. What a picture, isn't it? And on a treadmill, the gospel comes with words of power and peace, a peace that passes understanding. And then it says, you and I who know this grace from God, this peace from God, wow, God's going to use us. That's an incredible privilege. I hope it terrifies you, it does me. But I saw this passage as the one I wanted to preach on. I wished I was on holiday this week. It's awesome stuff. I've hardly scratched the surface. But here God is fulfilling exactly what he has planned. And therefore, as you read these words and grasp again how the church is to be, what the church is, then surely in our prayer meetings, in our private prayer, we are going to be asking God continually to forgive us for grieving him, to forgive us for quenching, and to refill us day after day after day after day after day. 365 days of the year, and for as many years as we live. Because it's through spirit-filled men and women that the Church of Christ is built. That's the basic maths of our business. Once you ever get away from that and begin to think it's up to gimmicks, it's up to how sweet we can be, it's up to how attractive we can make a building, then you've lost the plot. I've lost the plot. Pick me up if I do. You and I need to know that Jesus is building his church and that Jesus is present as and in the person of his Holy Spirit to do so, hallelujah, through you and me. Oh, that God would use us just to see one weary soul brought into the kingdom of God and a testimony of his glory and grace in Jesus' name. Amen.